Good afternoon, and thank you for participating in our webinar today. My name is Brett Smith. I'm the Director of Technology at the Center for Automotive Research, and our session today is Consumers and the Battery Electric Vehicle. And I want to start by taking a step back. As many of you know, that the Center for Automotive Research has the management car management briefing seminars, and I've run for almost 20 years now a propulsion powertrain session there. This year we did that again in a little bit different format, but it worked well. And during that session, I had two propulsion programs. First was, are we there yet? Looking at whether electric vehicles are ready for the mass market and the companies ready to produce. And Dustin Cruz of Volkswagen and Jörg Trompler from ZF talked about and really described an industry that is absolutely prepared and ready for a transition. The next day, we talked with Mike Robinette and Sandy Strakowski about that transition. How do suppliers go from being an internal combustion engine producer to being a battery electric vehicle producer? There's a big challenge in that. But as we pulled this together and performed it, we kind of ran out of time for a really important, really valuable part of this discussion. And that was the consumers. So today, we're going to continue that car MBS theme or session, but we're going to come back to what about the consumers? We know an industry is preparing for this. Whether or not they're all in or mostly all in, we can discuss, but there's clear sense that the industry has made a commitment to move forward into vehicle electrification and specifically into battery electric vehicles. The suppliers are going, the manufacturers are going. Now we're left with the consumers. How do we get to that next step? So for today's webinar, a great pleasure to have Britta Gross, who I've known for more than a decade, and is one of the leaders in this industry in the infrastructure side and connecting the consumers to the vehicles, to the utilities. And Mike DeBarnay, Vice President of Automotive and Mobility at Escalent, who's done some great research in this area of what it's going to take or what the consumer of the future is going to be like, or what that connection is for the consumer to the battery electric vehicle. Our format today is pretty simple. I'm going to step aside for the next 40 or 30 minutes and let Mike and Britta talk about their Britta presenting it kind of from Rocky Mountain Institute's goal of getting to 2030 and a massive and thorough acceptance of battery electric vehicles. But Mike's starting out and talking about what are the characteristics of consumers? And I remember about a year ago, actually probably a year ago this week in Chicago, Mike, at the North American International Powertrain Conference, I got up and I was carrying a hockey stick. And I said, you know, what is that hockey stick moment? Because Britta, I've been around the technology. I worry about what is that technology that's going to happen? And Mike said, you know, it may not be the hockey stick moment. Instead, it may be a lot of consumer type things happening and a lot of things from the consumer side that start to create that matches up with that technology. So I've been thinking about that for a year, Mike, and I think it's a good time later to talk about, is it a technology? Is it a consumer change? How do we connect those dots? Some time to talk about that going forward. With that, Mike, I'd like to turn it over to you and give yourself about 15 minutes to talk about the work you've been doing at Escalent.
Perfect. Thanks, Brett. All right. Hopefully everyone can see the presentation. And so what I'll do is I'll go ahead and get started. And basically, I want to talk through some of the results that we've found. We completed earlier this year a very extensive study focused on electric vehicle buyers. And I really want to just be able to share some of the findings that we have from that, because in some ways it challenges some of the thinking that's pervaded around what needs to get done to spur development or to spur adoption of EVs. So for anybody who hasn't heard of Escalent, for the last four decades, basically the role that we tend to play is one of basically being able to understand human behavior and help companies turn that into strategies that are successful. More often than not, that has us playing in spaces where there's a lot of disruption happening. You know, in automotive, for better or worse, that tends to be the constant these days. But, you know, EV is in particular an interesting space, just given the fact that there's so much energy, so many resources being put into EVs. And yet, in a lot of ways, there's this continued frustration of, you know, why aren't we seeing the results that we would like? And there's some pretty good human behavior lessons that we can bring to the table to talk to them. So I wanted to start out with just where are we in 2020? So we talked to over 10,000 new vehicle buyers. And one of the things that we wanted to do is to get a sense of, okay, you know, where is electrification? So, I mean, if I think back to 15 years ago when I was at GM and we were looking at just a whole litany of possible powertrains, there's basically been a coalescence in the consumer's minds around the fact that electrification is the future. And that's really helpful. I mean, that shows that a lot of the work that's been getting done is actually resonating with people. So basically 85% of these car buyers, they believe EVs are either the future or an interesting idea. So that's, you know, that's a great thing to have, sort of the wind in our sails. And moreover, over the last year, that view has actually gotten even more positive. So it's not just, you know, that it is positive, it's positive and it's growing. That said, you know, we look at, wait, we've got 85% of people saying they've got this positive view of EVs, and yet we're looking at, you know, sales of EVs as a percentage of new cars as something, you know, less than 2%. What's going on? And so that's really where the work that I do and oversee, it lives in that gap to say, okay, look, how do we help convert more of these people to buying EVs? What needs to get done? What, you know, what do they have to see? And so that's where, you know, some of the results I'll show today are going to speak to that. So a little bit of the results that I'm going to show, and of course, this will just be a small snippet of it, but basically what we did is we wanted to focus on next electric vehicle buyers. So there's been a lot of research done and continues to be done on people who own EVs. And there's, you know, plenty of research getting done on what's called hand raisers, so people who self-select. In a lot of ways, what we said is, look, if we're going to broaden the appeal of EVs, we have to be able to talk to people and get their views, even if they don't know enough today to say, I'm very interested in an EV. They have certain characteristics. We can understand what those are, and we can actually use those to identify people, even if they're not shopping right now and may not have a lot of knowledge about EVs. In order to do that, that's why we spoke to over 10,000 people. And in the end, we have over 600 data points from each of those individuals. So we took basically literally millions of data points and spent a couple months doing analytics on it to be able to identify who these next EV buyers are, and then in some pretty rich detail, be able to describe what it is that it's going to take to get them to convert to own an EV. And so far, the results basically, as we've been able to share some of these, we've gotten a really positive response because it's broken through in a lot of ways some of the frustration people have of results that aren't really actionable. So when we look at interest in battery electric vehicles, there's a couple of key things to take away. You know, we have, in terms of the number of new car buyers who today say that, look, no matter what, my next vehicle is going to be a battery electric vehicle, that's only about, you know, it's about 2% of the population. You know, on the other hand, though, if you look at how many people are waiting for a battery electric vehicle, that's been, you know, something where we look at, there's about 17% of people who say, look, I'm really interested in a battery electric vehicle. And essentially, I'm sold. However, I'm waiting for the right battery electric vehicle. I'm not going to go compromise on something that's important to me. So that to us is, we look at the fact that we're on the cusp of having literally dozens of vehicles that are coming in the next few years. It's exciting because in a lot of ways, there's a number of people who don't need necessarily to be convinced. They really need the right product. And that hopefully for a number of them is coming. We also looked at the number of people who said, look, a plug-in hybrid maybe could work for me, even though a battery electric vehicle can't. There's a couple OEMs in particular who place some bets saying, well, if you're not ready for a battery electric vehicle, plug-in hybrid is a logical step to that. You end up with about 10% of people who fit into that category, and we know a couple things about them. It is not universal. You can't assume if someone's not ready for a battery electric vehicle, a plug-in hybrid could work. For certain people, yes. For certain vehicle segments, yes. But for other ones, no, that's not the case. So there's a lot more depth we have around that that you can dive into to try to understand that. And then, you know, the gray and the dark gray areas of this pie is the reality that we face, that right now for their next vehicle, almost half of consumers just don't really have any interest in it. So they may have a positive view of EVs, but it doesn't mean that they're going to go out and buy one as their next vehicle. And then a really substantial part, more than a quarter of people who just simply don't know enough to have an opinion. So again, this is a little bit of background in terms of where we are. Let's talk about the buyers. I mean, we've now had EVs in the market for over a decade. How has that changed? So, you know, when you look at early EV buyers, we're a pretty extreme group. Demographically, they're higher income. They were certainly younger, tend to have the highest education of anyone who was out there. And importantly, and we, you know, picked this photo to demonstrate this, it was more of a situation of, you know, this is a nice house. There's usually multiple vehicles in the garage. And there's an EV like this smart ED that's pretty functionally compromised, and you've got people that are willing to work around that. That is not the case when we look forward, or even when we look back over the last couple of years at some of the buyers that are being attracted to the newer generation of mainstream EVs that have greater range. So what do we know about this next generation of buyers? So, you know, we're already now, we're almost 4 years into the Chevy Bolt having been on sale and really being the first of the mainstream vehicles to offer more than 200 miles range. And what we've seen in that time is there's a shift in the people that are attracted to it. You know, you end up with much more mainstream values and expectations of how the vehicle is going to be used. These vehicles are getting used more as the primary vehicle, whereas it was, you know, traditionally, in the early days, it was one of a couple vehicles generally somebody could turn to in their household, or even just for themselves. But there's a couple key things as well. I mean, there's a lot higher expectation that's coming with these new EVs. They have to perform and deliver, and, you know, in a lot of ways, parity to what people are used to with internal combustion engine vehicles. And to the extent that they don't, one of the key characteristics of this group of people, these newer buyers, is the fact that they're willing to wait. As I showed on the earlier pie chart, it dramatically outnumbers the number of people who for sure are going to buy an EV for the next vehicle are those that are saying, look, I'm ready, but just give me the right product and then I'll jump in, but I'm not necessarily going to compromise early to get into something. So part of our research also identified, you know, six different EV buyer personas. And so I want to talk to these a little bit because effectively, and, you know, as Brett referenced in the SAE conference we were at last year, I had pointed out the fact that, you know, we tend to, as an industry, and particularly from an engineering standpoint, fall into a couple of traps of where, well, we want to quantify problems and we sort of flatten out the world and make it more black and white than in reality it happens to be. And so, you know, whenever we hear things like, well, you know, EV buyers, they want technology, or they're there because it's green. The fact is that that's really not true. It's about diving into the details, gives you a richness, allows you to have some strategies that are going to work better. So of these six buyers, well, let's focus on the one to the far right called the torchbearer. And one of the things I want to point out is that, you know, effectively, there's a number below each of these the personas. And that's a number that through our analytics, we basically assign to every person, all the 10,000 people that went through our survey get this number, which is on a 0 to 100 scale, your likelihood to purchase an EV. It's in this case, we gave that number to each of these columns. I mean, it's an average for the group, but torchbearer is they're only about 4% of the new vehicle buying population. And in some ways they look like people who bought EVs in the past. You know, they are highest income, highest education. You know, they're really sort of politically pretty left-leaning. They're more likely to be considering to purchase a car or a luxury car. But there's a couple differences. So first of all, 90% of people in this group do not own an EV right now. They're not necessarily a group that thinks that a Tesla is going to work for them. They've got, you know, there's a number of things that for this group, they don't necessarily want to compromise when it comes to vehicles. So when I, you know, mentioned it's about delivering product or overcoming some of these barriers, this is a group that really that resonates true with. They are willing to work their lives around an EV a little bit more, but nowhere to the extent we saw with early EV buyers. In this group, one of the things that really characterizes it is that they believe climate change is a major problem, and they think EVs are the answer to that problem. So that's really, you know, that's kind of a key attribute. The young enthusiasts just to the left of them, they're not as high in terms of EV intention. This is a group that sometimes gets talked about as, oh, they seek out EV for the technology. Really, the way to say it is they seek it out for the technology, for the styling, and for the performance. It's the three of those things. That's what they seek. Because as a buyer, they're all about achievement and reward in their lives. And an EV helps basically, it's kind of the ideal mix of delivering on those attributes. They're the most ethnically diverse of all these buyers. They're most likely to be in an urban situation, and they're much more likely to want to buy a luxury or a sports car. By the way, this group is not environmentally motivated. That's just not something that really factors into it for them. From a messaging standpoint, that's something to keep in mind. One other thing, too, is young enthusiasts, much more than any of these buyers, tend to be influencers among their cohorts. And part of that, how that comes into play, is the fact that, you know, to the extent they can get experience with an EV, or they're likely to share it and to influence other people. Stewards, to the left of them, very similar score, a 54 versus a 57 compared to the young enthusiast. The difference is that stewards care about the environment as well. So we actually have two buyers that are pretty motivated by the environment, but it plays out in pretty different ways. Whereas torchbearers see EV as a technology that can help overcome some of these environmental issues. Stewards are much more of, it's an altruistic mindset. They care deeply about the world. They care about their communities. They want to help. They know EVs are a way to help that, but they are not car people. They more than anyone else are likely to turn to people that they know for an opinion on what vehicle they should buy. They tend to be intimidated by new technology. So they have a lot of questions for them. A lot of their barriers relate to things that are pretty fundamental, like what does maintenance look like? What does charging really look like? And, you know, battery longevity. Truly, for me, what can I expect? So that's more of a hurdle for this group, that when you understand that, you can start realizing how to help overcome that. This group, though, I should say, is they are, and if you look at these top three buyers, they're more likely to be looking at compact SUVs or cars. So there's also an intention here, or there's an impact of what kind of vehicle are you planning, or what is your strategy? You're going to attract different buyers. And when you know that, you can help tailor your strategies accordingly. I'm not going to spend any time on the three lower EV intention personas, except for one that I'll point out is Old Guard is the very bottom here with an EV Ford score of a 30. They think as a group, I mean, quote unquote here, climate change isn't real and EVs are a stupid idea. That said, they're a pretty informed group. They have money. There's a lot of traditional car enthusiasts that are part of this group, and they are more than anyone else more likely to buy pickup trucks. And so as we have a lot of EV pickup trucks coming, it's pretty interesting because Old Guard, they don't traditionally adopt anything new early, with one exception, and that is they will actually adopt advanced technology as it relates to, for instance, power tools or things that have functional benefits. So, you know, even in this case, with people who may not be an easy group to convert, there are ways you can tailor messaging or think about how products are positioned to break through. So last thing I want to point out here is basically the tipping point. Brett had mentioned it, when we think about anybody who says, oh, well, you know, it's all about cost parity with internal combustion engine vehicles. Well, our torchbearer and our young enthusiast, the top two, you know, images in the circle here, they are the least likely of all EV buyers, of all personas, all buyers in general, to be concerned about cost. they're much more willing, and they traditionally do spend a lot more on vehicles. So it's really about putting some of these assumptions in context and saying, look, it depends on who your buyer is. Sometimes cost is important. Sometimes it's really not. For those where cost isn't important, they're willing to pay for other attributes, but they need vehicles that are actually going to deliver on those attributes. The other thing I want to point out is the role of emotions. We really, from a buyer standpoint, a vehicle is traditionally an emotional purchase. When you then layer on top of that the fact that this is new technology, it's expensive technology, in a lot of ways, you find that it becomes even more emotional. And so EVs have a lot of appeal points for emotions. I mean, there's, in a lot of ways, messaging that can happen that's not just talking about how an EV is less bad than a gasoline vehicle, but how it's exciting in ways that people could never even think about. And so we really want to try to convey that idea that, you know, please be more creative in your thinking and understand that, you know, this is at its core an emotional purchase, at least on some level, for almost every consumer. And if you can understand that, it can help frame things up and allow things to, be accomplished more successfully. So thank you.
Mike, and I will come back for a moment as we transition over to Britta's presentation. Thank you very much. Again, I've seen this data a few times. I think it's really fascinating to me because, as you point out, so often we approach it from the technical aspect, but there's this consumer part of it. And so you've taken us to identifying the types of consumers. Britta, I think it's now, from your position at Rocky Mountain Institute, that idea of really bringing a broad application or a broad acceptance of that. So Britta, why don't you go ahead and take a few minutes to talk about the work you've been doing at Rocky Mountain Institute, and we'll come back with questions. Please remember, questions go in the questions, not in the chat. So if you want a question submitted, make sure it's in the questions part of it. And Britta, thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you, Mike. That was fabulous information there. Can you guys all see my slides just fine?
Yes.
Okay, very good. Yeah, so thanks for that introduction too, Brett. Yeah, Mike's information was so good and so on point. Let me just try to construct a bigger picture of where we need to get and then connect that to where consumers are. And it'll be nice for me to tap right back into what Mike, some of the points that Mike was making. So let's just hustle into this presentation right here. All right, so let's just start with where we need to get by 2030. If you take a look at climate science and the 50% carbon reduction we have to achieve by 2030, and we turn that into what does it mean for transportation? There are a lot of assumptions you make, but bottom line, we have to be well over 50 million EVs in the US by 2030. And that's about 1 in 5 electric vehicles, where today we've got about 1.5 million on the road. So just in the US, 1 in 5 vehicles minimum. In fact, it may even be as just tough as like 1 in 3 electric vehicles if you assume the grid just can't get quite green enough to support what we're trying to do here and you don't get enough out of building electrification, et cetera. So this is a big heavy lift, right? From 1.5 million vehicles to well over 50 million electric vehicles. That means that 17 states are gonna have more than 1 million EVs in them. And it also means that the corresponding number of DC fast chargers, you're gonna need home, workplace, level 2 public and DC public, but I only use DC as sort of a proxy for getting our arms around the magnitude of what has to get built in the next few years. We would need, according to NREL analysis that we've just scaled up at RMI, Rocky Mountain Institute, and then leveraging one of the Edison Electric Institute's assumptions about how many people have access to home charging. We need about 300,000 DC fast chargers. And I'll get into that in a minute. What do we have today and how far is that? But these numbers are stunningly aggressive. And again, if we're gonna make a meaningful or have a meaningful impact on climate and temperature, we've gotta get on pace today. And so when I think about Mike's information, you know, there's not really time to wait for everyone to get really comfortable with technologies and wait another 10 years. We've got to start this acceleration of adoption today. And that's where I'm coming from, is where do we have to get and quickly, how are we going to make this happen in really less than 10 years at this point? So where are the market barriers? Obviously battery and cost, and therefore the affordability of these technologies. Clearly, if these vehicles could be sold profitably for $22,000, it would be game over for the gasoline combustion engine, diesel combustion engine vehicles. People would be flocking to these vehicles, but cost still stands in the way. And there's been extraordinary progress in battery cost reduction, right? It's decreased about 85% since 2010, according to this BNEF data, which is pretty accurate here in my estimation. But it still has a long way to go to get to the point where the vehicles really can be produced at parity with a gasoline vehicle, not just in the luxury segments, but down in the mainstream segments where you're trying to get those prices well below $30,000 in MSP, in MSRP, in a MSRP sense. Second, lack of charging infrastructure. You really probably can never have enough, but we've got to get more to address the perception that there is enough infrastructure everywhere. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit. And then finally, building EV demand. A lot of that demand has to do with consumer perceptions, behaviors, and the kind of data that Mike was talking about. But we've got to drive consumer and fleet demand through, again, you can use infrastructure to do it, you can use pricing to do it, but you can also do it through policy and through awareness. So let's dig into some of these areas first. Let me just sort of build on consumer behaviors by showing you this map of the US. And in the year 2018, the last year I've seen whole data for this, what sectors, you know, what vehicle segments were predominant in the various states? Well, you can see that red represents states where the number one selling vehicle sector was in the crossover utility vehicles, CUVs, or compact utility vehicles, some would say, and the SUV segment. So across the board, you see this major shift that occurred, not just in the US, but also globally since maybe 2014, 2015, where there's been a massive movement and shift from car ownership up to crossover and SUV ownership. So, I mean, look at some of these numbers. 53% in Colorado, 53% of new vehicle purchases in 2018 were in that category of crossover and SUV. 40, look at the pickups there. 41% of all vehicles purchased in Wyoming and 40% in North Dakota are pickup trucks, of which there were zero, are zero in the marketplace today offered electric. So, I mean, these are things that are really important to take into consideration. And let me go show you the next slide that sort of, and it you know, I wanted to sort of give you a sense of since 2008 up to the end of 2019, what kind of vehicles were in the market. And here you see, I've just sort of flagged this and annotated it. The vast majority of vehicles for sale in the market or offered in the market, electric vehicles, were vastly cars, right? The Teslas, the Volt, the Bolt, these were all pretty much cars. I mean, they might be on the very, very left-leaning end of CUVs, crossovers. But generally speaking, the vast majority were cars. Only recently, maybe in the 2016, 2017 time period, have more CUVs and even SUVs been introduced. And in fact, if we look at the breakdown over here on the right-hand side in 2019, the segment breakdown of all the vehicles offered, electric vehicles, and you know, Tesla counts for maybe 8 or 9 of those models, cars accounted for about 50 of the vehicle offerings. Crossovers and SUVs, about 20 of the offerings. There were no electric pickup trucks in the market in 2019, and there was one single van by Chrysler, right? The Pacifica. So, I mean, we've obviously, you heard what Mike talked about, that consumers aren't rushing to get into a vehicle segment that they don't prefer. They're waiting to see the products they want in the form they want and the function they want. And so it's really important that there are more vehicles available in the market. It is not sufficient to make large-scale adoption happen. I would argue that it's a couple other things that have to happen too, including price and infrastructure. But it's obviously a starting point for some of those folks that are able to pay already today and just don't want to switch segments. If we now look at the next slide here, I've tried to put together all the vehicles, some of the key vehicles that are coming out in the next 3 years between the end of this year, 2020 and 2023, and a bunch of cars at the top again. But let me cast your eye down to the bottom half of the slide. And what I really wanted to show you is just look at the larger SUVs and pickup trucks that are coming to market. And it's just, it's no surprise that automakers are seeing and listening to consumers who are saying, we want to buy vehicles, we want to buy electric, but I'm waiting for the product that looks like the kind of product I want to drive. They're also, automakers, I would argue, are looking for products that can be done profitably. And so you're going to start to see this more in the luxury, the larger profit margin vehicles also. So again, it doesn't bode well for getting products into the market that are in the lower price ranges. But boy, talk about offering brands and models that some folks are waiting for. And I'm just really excited. I mean, if I think about the Ford F-150 here coming out next year, really excited to see this one take hold, and let's see what can happen in Texas or in Colorado or in Wyoming to some of those, I can't remember what you called it, Mike, defenders or something like that. Okay, on the next slide, let's talk just briefly about infrastructure. Again, great improvement and growth in infrastructure, charging infrastructure since 2010, but certainly even in the last 5 years since 2015, when DC fast charging really started to take a hold. And so you see, I have a snapshot of a very old slide that I actually used in presentations back in 2015. At that time, there were only 204 stations in the US that delivered the DC fast charging compliant with the SAE industry standard, which basically applies to every vehicle out there except for the Teslas that have their own network, and the CHAdeMO system, which looks like now with the Nissan Ariya announcement that it's also moving and will be SAE compliant on charging. It looks like that now is broadly speaking the definitive standard here for the US. And look at what's happened just since July of 2015, when I argue the SAE standard is pretty new. Now there are today, I looked just yesterday, 3,297 stations, which have, you know, on average 3-4 chargers per site, 6,500 DC fast chargers. Of course, I could show you a map with level 2, but the map gets so cloudy, you can't quite see what's really happening. But you really start to see sort of the patterns. You can start to see sort of crisscrossing highways and interstates across the US from east to west, some of the corridors from north to south that are starting to be built up too. So great progress, but just nowhere near. Remember, I said 300,000 DC fast chargers would be needed in 2030 to satisfy the needs of 50 million electric vehicles, which is needed to address climate. And so you see how far off the mark we are and how much we have to accelerate the installation of these chargers today. Where's the investment been coming from? This is another one of our challenges and opportunities. There have been three large areas of investment for EV charging infrastructure in the last, I would just say, 5 years. Electrify America, of course, the settlement that VW reached with the Department of Justice, CARB, and EPA. And so that has led to the, you know, Electrify America's agreement to spend up to, you know, spend $2 billion. Much of that will be spent on EV charging infrastructure. And you can see what nice storytelling there is when you look at when a single entity is allowed to or required to build infrastructure and wants to achieve a mission of making sure that you can get from the East Coast to the West Coast and from the northern borders down to the southern borders. We almost got the whole thing covered except that sort of upper section of, you know, from Minnesota west over to Montana. That's got to be taken care of pretty soon here. But that was a big investment area. The other one's another VW settlement in the middle column. These are the funds that VW had to pay to the states to mitigate NOx emissions. And so you can see that in green are all the states that have committed to spending up to 15% of their state allocated funds towards EV charging infrastructure. So in the green states, we expect to see more infrastructure as a result of those commitments. Three states are spending it elsewhere. But that's still a great accomplishment there on the 47 states out of 50. And the third bucket of where funding is coming on from infrastructure in the last few years is utility investment. And this is just a summary from the Atlas EV Hub. And this just summarizes where IOUs, so the investor-owned utilities, the large utilities that are regulated by their state regulators in the public filings, where $1.5 billion of the green states in there, $1.5 billion has already been approved for utilities to go out and invest in EV charging infrastructure and EV related stuff. And then $1.5 billion is pending, still waiting for regulator approval in those states for the utilities to go in. But it still leaves some open space in many of the other states that have not seen any regulator utility filings. And here I don't include municipal utilities, and I don't include the rural co-ops, but just as sort of a way to look at where the funding is coming from. I think this is really important. To get to the kind of scale we're talking about by 2030, We need to see all 3,200 utilities investing at an even accelerated, more accelerated pace than we have today. Every utility should be engaged and investing in what's needed for this transformation of transportation. But alone, utilities can't do it. We've got to find a way to get rid of some of the cost barriers that are in the marketplace that make it not profitable for private investment to get into these markets. That's what's been really missing, is to date, only since 2010, only 13% of all investment in public charging has come from private sector. And that's not enough to scale a market that's got to be, you know, market driven eventually. And so we need to really focus on that thing, but we got to get some cost out of the system. We're losing time. I think there are a lot of debates out there when a utility wants to file a project for investing in charging. There are a lot of debates in states, way too many debates. They talk about who's, you know, the regulators are skeptical. They don't know about the risk, you know, cost shifting from EV drivers to non-EV drivers. Who should really be paying for infrastructure? I will just argue that all of these arguments are very short-term issues. These are not long-term issues. When EVs are in scale in the marketplace and all that revenue has been driving to the utilities through home charging and workplace charging, which is really the big workhorse and where charging is predominantly done, there will be revenue coming in that will help, you know, that will spread across to all ratepayers. It's just simply we're debating an awful lot right now that I would like to see sort of let's move off of that and let's look at the big picture where we have to get and really what it takes just to get through these first early years when the business case really on every angle isn't quite profitable yet. Why electrify? I'm not going to spend any time on here, but there are reasons on the left-hand side. This is why consumers and vehicle, you know, drivers or fleet managers, how they benefit from electric vehicles. But on the right-hand side is how society benefits, how the state benefits through economic growth. And there are many, many studies out there that demonstrate that on average over the 15 year life of an electric vehicle, a state will benefit by $7,000 per vehicle introduced in that state, largely or as a result in, you know, of the fact that when you look at gasoline dollars, more 90% of a dollar spent on gasoline in your state typically leaves your state and goes to some other state or some other country that's producing or refining oil. It's the opposite case for you for electricity. 90% of the dollar you spend for electricity in a state typically stays within that state because utilities operate locally. They generate typically locally. And so that's a really important economic growth factor for states to consider. So again, I won't go through all this stuff, but there is a societal benefit and a state economic benefit in driving EV growth that I haven't even begun to talk about, the jobs created through infrastructure. And then maybe just quickly, policy plays a big role. It's not a mystery why California is so successful with EVs. They've been at it a lot longer than the other states, right? They've had this dialogue about the environment and energy use for decades now. And they also have a robust portfolio of policies, both monetary and non-monetary, that drive a constant drumbeat and a constant activity to incentivize and drive awareness, et cetera. And you look at the other states, I mean, you kind of get what you put into the effort, and you can kind of see why EV adoption doesn't have a chance of really growing if you're not sort of putting in the work. So I think that that's something to be learned for really broadly across the US. And then finally, just wrapping up pretty quickly here, I just wanted to sort of talk about, you know, what's happening in other parts of the world as folks and countries look at climate, they look at air quality, we're looking at health issues, especially in connection with COVID and where the vulnerabilities, where, you know, where the vulnerabilities come another effect in the line after air quality affects your general health. And then, of course, here comes COVID, and that affects it leaves you more vulnerable to those kinds of illnesses and diseases. And so, you know, here we have countries around the world that have begun to put a stake in the ground saying, we don't want to see combustion engine vehicles, either diesel and or gasoline, at some point in time in the future. And so here are the commitments that I'm tracking. There are a bunch of cities in the list over there to the left. You know, nothing is regulated, nothing by law sort of yet, but this is a wave of recognition that it may take a little bit of a coaxing to get these markets to grow fast enough in addressing the issues that we have. And finally, maybe leave you with this one message also, that a vehicle that we buy on average sits on the streets and drives on the roads in the US for about 12 years. 25% of vehicles we drive today are more than 16 years old. And so you see how just the stock ages. And so if we're still purchasing in 2035, if we're still purchasing gasoline and diesel vehicles, you can see how we will still be managing and maintaining these vehicles even in the 2050 timeframe. And I think that's something that no one really foresees being either where I want to be as a fleet operator, maintaining these vehicles. And it's certainly not where society wants to go with these vehicles. So just as a sort of a trend line, I think that's important. Let me just skip to the very last slide for sake of time. You know, is 50 million a lot of vehicles? And I said that's sort of the minimum bar we've got to get to by 2030. It is actually very doable when you sort of look at the list of, you know, who's in a position to get these vehicles. Mike talked a little bit about, you know, the household income of folks that have been buying electric vehicles so far. Well, in reality, in 2019, the average transaction price for a new vehicle in the U.S. was almost $39,000. And so when you look at EVs on the market today for 2028, 30, 32, 35, there are quite a few vehicles available for under that price bar of $38,000, $39,000. So, you know, we're sort of in the right ballpark today. Is it the right form and function of the vehicle? That's another issue that I did try to talk about earlier. 60% of Americans live in single family homes with access, presumably, to an outlet. I've been using an outlet for 10 years for my electric vehicles. And so just plug it into the, you know, the outlet in your garage or outside the home. 66% of Americans have two vehicles in the household. So this idea of I can have an electric vehicle, and if it just doesn't serve every notional, you know, what if scenario, maybe I borrow or swap out the other car that I have in the household. And then 80% of Americans commute less to and from work less than 40 miles a day. So when I sort of list all the things, you know, where should this work? Not instead of like, in what cases doesn't it work? We're all famous for talking about it doesn't work here, it doesn't work in this case. There are a lot of instances where we ought to be able to get one in five of us into an electric vehicle in the next 10 years. And that's what I think we ought to work for and just focus on the goal for 2030. So with that, I thank you for your time and really look forward to questions.
Britta, thank you so much. And Mike, thank you. You're joining us back. I was just thinking, when I had the car MBS propulsion sessions and I talked about the car companies and the suppliers and the transition of the suppliers, and as their presentations were going, I thought, we need that consumer part to this. And I started to think, who would bring that consumer part to this? I will argue that you two can bring that as well as anybody in the business. And it was really, really fascinating to hear both of you. Mike, the data you have is remarkably in-depth and thoughtful. And Britta, your knowledge, experience, and enthusiasm is just a fabulous combination. So thank you both for that. And not surprisingly, we have a whole lot of questions. So I'm going to try to get to the questions, group some of them. We have about 15 minutes left. So the first, Mike, is just a simple clarification or explanation. So Mike, you said that young enthusiasts were not interested in the environment. I thought the young millennials cared most about the environment.
That's a really good point. I think the way to characterize it is if you ask the young enthusiast group, do you care about the environment? The answer you're going to get is, well, sure, of course. A lot of the work we did looked at their behavior, and what we found is in their behavior, there isn't, for that group, they don't do as much that, you know, not as much of their lifestyle revolves around actually doing things that are really good for the environment. So, and part of it I should say is, this is as it relates to electric vehicles. So, you know, the young enthusiast group, they certainly do care about the environment in the sense that they want it to be better, but other things are gonna rise to the top when it comes to why they're buying an EV. And it's gonna be things like, you know, performance, styling, and, you know, and really the technology aspects of it.
Britta, there were a couple of questions I wanted to go down path with you on. First, the simple one, why the 50 million unit target? Where does that come from? What's the vision for it, the driver behind it?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty extensive modeling, but it's really 20% of the vehicle car park here in the United States. That equates to 50 million vehicles. And predominantly, right, it's all light duty vehicles here in the United States. Light duty vehicles account for, I think, 60% of transportation emissions. So it becomes the largest sector to be able to attack. But it comes from the 20%, of course, the carbon reduction goals, according to, you know, the best in class science on where we need to be by 2030, 2040, and 2050, suggests that we've got to get about 50% of carbon or CO2 out of our, you know, out of our emission system by 2030. And to get to that 50%, it requires at least 20% vehicle electrification. It also, that goes hand in hand with another very difficult challenge of, I think the assumption is 30% vehicle mile traveled reduction, which is why we're all looking very carefully at you know, working from home and what that's meant to travel patterns and vehicle miles traveled, because that could be a very important source of tapping into that. So it's a combination of how green is the grid going to get, because the greener it is, the fewer vehicles you have to electrify to some extent. The VMT also offsets the number of vehicles that have to be electrified and so on. So it's a number of factors that all line up, but it's at a minimum, you can see 20% of this vehicle park out there, cars and trucks, have to be electrified.
Back in February, Britta, I had the opportunity to join your group, RMI, for a stakeholders discussion on this. And, you know, coming from the Midwest and the auto industry, I found it to be a really, really diverse group of stakeholders, probably different in some cases than you saw back at your days at General Motors. You have, with RMI, you have now a different perspective. What would you tell the Britta Gross back at General Motors about connecting with and understanding those diverse stakeholders?
So I would actually just interpret it a little bit differently. I would say that the stakeholders that I am bringing in to help address these exact kind of questions, like what's it going to take, everybody talk to me. I think that it is broadly the same stakeholder group. But what was always missing for me is, you know, when I was sort of in industry, it was a focus on how do we grow from 1%, how do we double that to 2%, to 4%, to 8%. And what I'm doing differently now that I'm part of an NGO community trying to elevate this dialogue and get some action to happen is to align stakeholders on where do we have to get, where do we want to be? Where can we make, what makes a difference? And then let's work backwards from that point of, for example, 20% electrification at a minimum. Work backwards, what does it take? What's standing in the way? Is it the way we do installations? Is it a cost barrier in the market that prevents private investment? Is it the way the regulatory environment allows or does not allow utilities to invest and engage during these early years, et cetera? So that's the only thing that's really changed for me is, can we gather enough alignment about where we have to get? And then let's step back and now let's all go do our homework. So don't think 1%, 2% increments. Think about where we have to get and what that means every year. To get today from 5,000 DC fast chargers up to 300,000, just do the math, divide by 10, how many chargers, DC fast chargers, we should be installing every year starting today. And every year, this is a key point, every year that we don't start EV, you know, getting the infrastructure on the ground, getting more awareness out there, getting more products out in the field, and getting consumers to adopt these, including fleet operators, is just shoving a burden to the next year, a higher burden for the next few years. So action today is really critical.
Very good. So Mike, there's a couple of clarifications, and then I want to come back to the product blitz discussion. First, I guess I saw somewhere in this long list of questions, This is a North America based or a US based survey that you're doing? Where was your population taken?
That's a really good question. Yeah, the study results I talked to, this is just a US based population, but we've actually had really strong response to what we've done. So we're planning right now to take this international this next year. But so far, everything I shared is just from the United States.
And another question that kind of goes to clarification, what percent of the total vehicle buying population do the EV considering personas represent? Those that you described as they were considering it.
100%. So basically, 100%. Basically, we took every The way to identify the who these EV buyers were, we started with basically a cross-section of the entire new vehicle buying population. And so those six personas, so basically every new car buyer would fit into one of those six. But one of the things I have to point out, because people will love to look at segmentations and say, well, you know, I don't feel like I necessarily fit into one of these perfectly. It's a segmentation that was created to understand why people are attracted to EVs. And so it's those motivations around EV that define those six different the six different personas. Because in the end, we looked at over 65 different combinations of segmentations and ultimately landed on those six. But yes, they include everybody. All new car buyers fit into one of those six.
Very good. So let's go back to both of you talked about the product push, this amazing blitz of real quality stuff that appears to be on the near horizon, starting with the Model Y, the Mach-E, the ID4, just this year, three cars that strike me as really, really real competitors. I mean, just actual vehicles, things that people look at and say, that works for me. There's also, I think I saw 125 EV models planned between now and 2024, 2025. That's a lot of product. How do we avoid the challenge of two or three or four of them being successful and the rest not? How do we know that, and I hear often, there's gonna be a few that make it and most won't. And then follow that up with, and Mike, maybe your data on consumers helps us believe that that's gonna happen. And Britta, your challenge on getting people into those cars back to your goal might help us there. But then push that to the pickup truck. So first it's gonna be the CUVs, probably not SUVs, but CUVs and then pickup trucks. And pickup trucks, in a lot of ways, don't make sense for electrification in the traditional way. So Mike, talk about that product blitz coming on, how it fits with what you learned, and then Britta, maybe you can carry on from there.
Sure. Yeah. And I mean, one of the things I wanted to point out is Britta in her, you know, in her talk had mentioned things like price and infrastructure and vehicle availability. And I want to make sure that everyone knows from the data that I talked about, it's not to say that, you know, even though we have a couple groups where price sensitivity isn't the same, obviously, you know, price is still really important. Infrastructure is important and vehicle availability. So I think we're in alignment on those. In some ways, it's trying to reframe those or be more specific. But I do think, I mean, look, what lies in front of us is, you know, there's a challenge to the extent that for a lot of these more mainstream-like consumers, they're dealing with vehicles right now that meet their needs, that they're used to. So it's a high hurdle to overcome. And so that's where, you know, I think that when you get into the details, though, you realize some of those barriers when it comes to product availability. You know, you have people that, for instance, I'm a Subaru loyalist and I'm on my 12th Subaru and I'm going to wait for Subaru to have an EV before I get one. For other people, it may be, you know, I'm currently driving a Toyota Highlander and I really want a vehicle that's mainstream, that has, you know, three rows. So I think that bodes well for the number of products that are coming, because it's not just one, you know, it's not just a lack of, say, SUVs. It's a lack of, you know, certain brands and certain kinds of SUVs and certain things. So I think all that comes into play. I mean, are there going to be winners and losers? Absolutely. There's no question about that. But, you know, the fact that a lot of this product that's coming seems to be getting past what I have seen over the last decade more of, which is, you know, the EV powertrain is really expensive. So let's strip out the cost out of the vehicle and then be surprised when we put basically a $40,000 car with $20,000 car worth of content in it, and then why people don't jump at that. So I'm optimistic that some of that is changing and can help draw more people in.
So Britta, you talked about the CUVs, and then you raised this idea of pickup trucks. In a lot of ways, pickup trucks strike me as a really strange electrification or battery electric thing, because they need very large batteries, which makes them pretty expensive to do the full duty cycle of a diesel pickup truck. There's niches and other spots for the pickup trucks. How do those roll out over the next couple of years?
Yeah, I mean, I guess when you talk about pickup trucks, and maybe Mike has data somewhere in the archives about who buys pickup trucks, right? Not all are going, you know, not all are traveling 600 miles a day hauling bales of hay. There are a lot of urban and suburban pickup driver owners for that. You know, once a year, you help move your brother's furniture or something. So, I mean, I think that there are some real, I think there is a real opportunity there. Again, the automakers are going into those segments. From what I can see, they're going mostly into those segments where they can continue to be, where they can try to find some profitability in technology where the batteries are still a little expensive. I think everyone believes, I believe there's broad agreement that in the next 5 to 7, 8 years, we will have very price competitive batteries. It's just waiting. And again, I got a mission here, and that mission doesn't wait for, let's just wait for all costs to come out of these systems, and then we'll really ramp up in 2029 and 2030. We got to get going today. And so this is this problem. And without the market certainty, I mean, when I brought in all of industry players and the dealers association, the utilities and the regulators, what you hear is that if there were just some signals that gave them confidence about where the market was and how important it was to produce these vehicles in the near term, it would be a very different game. But given the luxury of some time to keep waiting for prices to come down, they're going to put these products in those categories that can actually produce a little bit of profit.
So, Mike, I want to come back. Actually, there were several questions that talked about consumers that buy the vehicles and are disappointed with range, or then understand that the next year or the year after's EV is so much better because of, Britta talks about the cost and the battery technology or performance. When you talk to these survey folks, the consumers, how do they adjust to the fact that yes, there is a range? Do they understand sometimes there's that range problem, but also how do they adapt to the technology changing so rapidly? People know that last year's EV is not nearly as good as next year's EV, and that's not the same with a battery or with an internal combustion engine car.
It's true, but one of the things that I think is helping that dialogue is the fact that when you look at the importance of, say, infotainment systems for vehicles in terms of purchase consideration, how much that's risen and how quickly that changes. I mean, you're seeing a shifting mindset even outside of powertrain towards, look, I know that I'm getting a vehicle that has some advanced technology and I know it's going to be out of date, but, you know, you can kind of wait forever. And I think that's where, so it's not exclusive to EV powertrain. I also think to the extent you're dealing with, I mean, I'll give an example of the Chevy Bolt. How many people we spoke to over the years who bought a Chevy Bolt and said, you know, look, I had all these expectations of how much range I would need, but then when I left my garage every morning with a full battery, I realized 200 miles range was more than sufficient. I'm only now charging twice a week. Yeah, okay, the new, you know, the Bolt now has 250 miles range. You know what? That's great for next time I buy, but I'm not feeling wounded because I now was, you know, I had sort of more than I thought I needed. So that's great for next time. But I think that was a different issue when you were dealing with an EV that, you know, effectively would get maybe 60 to 80 miles range. Yeah. That was much more of a pain point.
Yeah, I would add here, because I think this is a really important point here. The difference between the experience and what a current EV driver knows about electric vehicles and what's adequate in range, what's adequate in the speed of recharge, what's enough public infrastructure is far different and much less demanding than what the public who has no familiarity thinks they're going to need. Everyone thinks you've got to see a DC fast charger on every single station or this doesn't work. The rest of us who are driving EVs know either we've never been to a DC fast charger or maybe 4% of the time. I mean, it's just the gap between experience and this assumption of how much has to be right for me to take this move to transition over to an EV is just complete worlds apart. And we've got to try to get these experiences to folks so that they don't see the EVs as such a mystery.
So we are out of time with this last follow-up. Britta, you used to work at a car company, so you can get a perspective on this, and Mike, you can close it out. But is the best way to get to 1 out of 5 vehicles on the road being electric is to get people in the seats of electric vehicles to test them? Yeah. How do you do that?
Yeah, it's, you know what? Everyone who's driving an EV hand your keys to some person in your family, someone, a relative, a colleague when we used to go into the office. Get people to drive these vehicles. Get them in the car for 30 minutes. It'll change every single assumption about these vehicles. A broad loaner programs would be huge. It is the number one thing you can do to drive sales. We saw that when I was at GM. I see it now.
So let me ask this, what's RMI doing about getting loaner programs?
Yeah, that's a good one. All right, I'll write it down.
I'm sorry. I'm going to close this out here. Look, we've got so many questions. And like, you two are just absolutely fantastic for this discussion. I really appreciate it. Unfortunately, we're kind of out of time because there's so much more to talk about. But Mike, close us out on that idea.
I couldn't agree with Britta more. We're really finding that if you can get people in the seats, it demystifies it so much of, wow, this drives just like a normal vehicle. It's, you know, people come in with, you know, our research has shown time and time again with some pretty wild assumptions of what they think an EV entails, and actually getting into one really helps break that down. And so I would push anyone who, whether it's dealer loaner programs or the number of people I've spoken to where they travel to Europe and, you know, the rental car happened to be an electric. They thought it was going to be the end of their trip. And by the time, you know, by day two, they had completely fallen in love with it. I do think that is it goes such a long way in demystifying it. And I think there's also the reality of the world we live in today is an OEM getting on mainstream media and saying, hey, it's going to be great for you, doesn't really resonate with a lot of people. But if you can put their butts in the seats, you can really drive some change.
So I remember doing an interview in 2002 with the media person, and they said, what's going to create an electric vehicle buyer? And my argument at that point was, you can't tell them it's the same. You have to tell them it's different and understand what great parts of the different can be used to leverage. This comparison of it doesn't do the exact things of an ICE. It may never do that, or not in the near future, but it does so many things so wonderfully that there's that perspective of, let's make it just like the ICE versus let's make it the best vehicle you can own. And with that, first to all folks attending, thank you very much. A great list of questions, and I'm literally scrolling down through those, so many good questions. I apologize for not getting through them. Mike and Britta, as I said, just perfect for this. Thanks so much, and let's keep this conversation going.
Perfect.
You bet. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, everybody.
Take care, everyone.